Well, welcome back, guys. Today, the second game we're playing on game night is City of Horror. This is a game where you're playing a group of human survivors with a struggle against trying to survive the zombie apocalypse. The game, basically you're trying to survive, but your own survival is the most important. You yourself wants to get out of the City of Horror. The game takes place over four rounds. You're in this game, you're going to portray people. You're going to you care about yourself. That's it. Right? You don't care if the other people die. You want to get out of this city. You got to survive four rounds, which basically each round represents an hour before the helicopter gets here. But in order for your survivors to get onto the helicopter, they each had to have a vaccine. Then the person with the most points is the winner. So let's learn how to play this game. So first, everybody's going to get four survivors at random. A little player aid that shows you what happens. This is basically the four rounds. Then you get a set of location cards, and this is how you're going to move. And everybody also gets six of these item cards. The people and item cards represents how many people. So if you're playing with three players, you'll get five characters instead of four. If you were playing with four players, which I have set up here, you will only get four characters. Five and six, everybody gets three. So the more players you have, the less characters you have. And the same thing with these action cards. In a three-player game, you get seven, four, six. Five players, you get five, and six players, you get four. And these things are very limited. If I use them all up in one turn, that's it. Unless I could get some more, which I'll explain later how you get these. But these are not just cards where you can just use them and then, I want a new one. I use this one. Draw another one. Nope. Once you are out, you are out. So this is like a real zombie apocalypse. But yeah, that's the start of the game. Like I said, everything is random. All the people are random that you get. And let's learn about the first step. And also part of setup, the person who looks more like a zombie gets the first player marker. So, yep, that's this. So as you can see here, the first thing that everybody will do out of the four rounds is movement. So basically what everybody's gonna do is they're gonna look at their handy dandy small little movement cards right here. Each person has the same one. They're gonna pick them all up, look at them, decide where they wanna go. As you can see, the monsters are on the board. Decide where they wanna go and they'll pick one. So let's say I wanna go to the hospital. I will pick it without anybody seeing and I'll put it face down in front of me. All right, once everybody has just done, pick their movement card. So everybody's picked their movement card. The next step is we're gonna reveal basically one of the zombie cars where more zombies are gonna come out. So that's what this means, is we're gonna take that deck because this represents the four rounds. Once this deck is out, that's the end of the game. So that's the second part. After everybody did the movement, or like picked their movement card without showing anybody because they're all still face down, we'll reveal the card to see where zombies go. Now sometimes you might be at a place that lets you look at an advance at this card. Basically how to read this card is sometimes something will be up here. So let's find a card with that. So I found a card, and then you're going to do everything on top and then down at the bottom. So basically what this means right here is all the zombies from space four is going to move to space one. So if you look on the board, each spot is numbered. So there's four, six, There's one, there's two, and then three. So basically all the zombies over here in four are gonna move over here in front of one. So that's the first thing you'll do. Like I said, usually I will probably take care of this. The person with the most experience in the game or knows how to play the game will take care of this part, but sometimes you might activate something or you might have a card that lets you look at this. So now you know, up here it'll just say a number going to another number. So you'll know that four, all the zombies for the four are going to one. Now this right here means three zombies are going in front of four, one antidote is going to four, and one card, action card, is going to four. This is the only way you can get action cards in the game, is from these drops. And this says one is going at space six, nothing is going at one, five is going, or two is going to five, and then two is going to three. And then right here, the little plus one basically means this little zombie face is going to move one space that way. So now that you know how the card works, so everybody did the movement, so let's go ahead and set up, let's go ahead and do the second part, actually looking at the card and set up on how this round is going to happen. So we'll draw the next card, and the next card will say 1 o'clock on it, and then the next one will be two, three, then four. After the fourth one, that's the end of the round, or that's the end of the game. So we'll look at, we're gonna look at this one. So this one says two zombies at four, one at six, two zombies at one with two antidotes, one zombie at five, one antidote and one card at three, and two at space two. So let's go ahead and I'm gonna go ahead and put those out and let's see what happens. So we set this up. As you can see, get the zombies and the antidote on those spaces that are supposed to be at. And this one also has some antidotes and cards. Next step we're gonna look at is the movement. So this is the part where you actually move. So that's why it might be a benefit sometimes to look at that card. So sometimes you can change your movement if you play an action card. But right now you have to move to the spot you pick. So let's talk about the movement now. All right, so starting with the first player and going clockwise, each person is going to reveal their movement card and they have to move a character there. There's a few rules, so let's just go ahead and talk about them. So I'll reveal my card. Now, one of my characters, see, at the start of the game, we're gonna have these already around the board. I just don't have them there now. So let's say I have some people, two people at the hospital, and one person at the bank, and one person in the crossroads. Now, I have to move somebody to the hospital. It could be anybody that's out of the hospital, basically. I cannot be like, oh, I'm just gonna keep this person into the hospital. I have to move either him or her into the hospital. So somebody that's not in the hospital has to go to the hospital. And there's a limited number of space, as you see the bubbles here, that's the spaces that you will go at. So right now I already have two. Let's say blue has one there and red has one there. So I wanted to move her to the hospital, but I can't, it's full. So now she has to go to the crossroads. Everybody has to move. So red will do the same thing. Reveal their card. They also chose the hospital. He can't go to the hospital, so he goes in the crossroads. And we'll just go around and everybody will do the same thing. All right, so that is the movement phase. And like we'll talk about some of the action card, because sometimes you can play an action card that lets you change your movement after you see everybody else's, or lets you make your own space. And sometimes you might be able to use an ability of a person that lets you make your own space, and so on and so forth. So the next thing we are going to look at is we're going to resolve each one of these locations starting from 1 and going to 6. So when you do that, you're going to look at each location and whoever's there gets to resolve it. So let's take a look at 1 and then 2 and 3 and 4 and 5, 6. So here is a space 1, as you could read the number. Basically, anybody that has at least one person on this spot can activate this spot. So basically, you can discard, what that symbol means, you could discard one of your action cards to draw another one. And even if you have two people here, you can only do that once. So once everybody has done that, if they want to, then we'll move on to the second space, and then third space, and then fourth space. So let's take a look at space 2. So this one is space 2. So basically what that means is for one, or you can exhaust one of your people, because like I said, each person has a special ability, and once you use that ability, they become exhausted. And as you see, they're worthless at the end. So she's worth 3, not exhausted at the end, but if she's exhausted by the end of the game, she's only worth 2. But you can exhaust one of your people, so if I don't ever want to use her ability or whatever, I can exhaust her and get one antidote. So that's, and like I said, antidotes are important in this game because you need antidotes, at least for your characters, to even have their points even count at the end. You could also use antidotes to, if I want later on want to use her ability, I can discard an antidote to flip her back over. All right, so the third space is basically you just get to move this little middle guy over one. So if they're blank spaces, then you move it to blue. If it's already on blue, then you move to red and so on and so forth. That's what that one does. So space 4 basically is you discard one of your action cards and you could flip over one of your exhausted people. So if she was exhausted and she was over here at space 4, she could flip it over, but she has to get rid of one of her action cards. All right, space 5 is the crossroads. So basically what this is you can discard one action card to get one of these, and these are worth points at the end. So if you have somebody at the water tower at the start of the next turn, that's when this will come into effect. Basically, this is the one where you can play your movement card after you saw everybody else's, so after everybody else plays theirs, so you can see where everybody else is going, but before we do the revealing monsters and stuff. So if she's still there, she gets to do that next turn. So the next part of the whole activation, so once everybody has if they wanted to activate at the space that they're on, zombies are going to attack if the conditions are met. But before zombies attack, people can try to play cards from their hand. So if the conditions are met at that location, then there's going to be attack. But first, like I said, we'll start at space 1, and everybody, even if you don't have somebody at that space, anybody could play cards to try to help them out. But sometimes you might not want to help them out, because like I said, this game is basically you're in it for yourself. You are trying to get your people out, and not so much as the others. So be careful who you help. I mean, you can help people and then backstab them later, or so on and so forth, or whatever. You can just make alliances with everybody. So we'll look at space 1, and then 2, and then 3. So over here at space 1, as you can see, if there are 3 or more zombies at this space, they are going to attack. And if nobody here wants to play cards, or if they don't have any cards to play, somebody's going to die. But let's say they played a card, and they're able to kill 2. Basically, what that means is this place is not going to get attacked anymore from the zombies. And then we'll move on to the next phase. But if nobody's going to, they're going to have a vote. And if you're not present here, you cannot vote in this part right here. Basically, blue will have 2 votes because they have 2 people there. Red has 1, yellow has 1. And basically all they're voting for is to see who's going to die. Somebody has to die if the zombies are not killed. So amongst those three people, those three players, they're going to pick a character to die. Whoever has the most votes for, let's say everybody voted for the thief, then the thief is going to die. If it's a tie, which it probably will be because since it's 1-1, but they blue has two, the whoever has the first player marker will decide, will break the tie. And you can make any kind of deals. You can say, oh, I'll help you out next one. If you're in the same pickle, or I'll give you an action card or whatever. You can do anything. But somebody has to die. So that's the zombie attack, and we'll do that for all the spaces that are met if you don't kill the monsters. After the zombies have attacked or did their thing, we're going to decide who gets the stuff at this location. So this, the zombies are attacked. Let's say this one got killed and there's only one zombie there, so it doesn't meet that criteria anymore. Now between these two, this is the time where everybody can vote. Everybody's going to vote, even if you don't have a person there. You're going to decide, or you're going to, anybody can discuss anything, but you can only vote if you have a person there. But you can easily persuade people to help you out. So basically in this situation, there's two different colors here. So basically, between those two, they're probably going to vote against each other unless they come up with something. But one person is going to get everything. So let's say blue wins. They take the antidote and card. Now, they can distribute it however they want. If they win the vote, they can keep both of them. They can say, oh, I was lying, I'm keeping both of these for myself. Or they could say, oh, I want to give the antidote to red and I'm going to keep the weapon or whatever. He can do whatever he wants. Same thing with red. If red would have won that, she would get both and she could distribute it however she wants. And like I said, whoever has the first player marker will break the ties. So if they're a tie right now, if I'm the first player, I can say, well, I want, if you give me the antidote, I'll let you, you know, I'll let you win this since it's a tie right now. And if you give me the antidote and you keep the weapon, then I'll let you win. So, but he doesn't have to keep his word, but then I will remember that next time for when I break ties or anything. So yeah, that is the voting. So that is all the rounds. So once the voting is done at the location, then we'll just end the round and we'll start all over by picking movement cards, revealing the next card, moving our characters, and then resolving each location. We'll do that three more times. Whoever has the most points at the end wins. Now let's talk a little bit about the Crossroads. The Crossroads is a little bit different than all the other places. Usually, if the monsters are going to attack, there's a vote on who gets eaten, basically. Not in the Crossroads. The Crossroads, if the monsters are going to attack, which it, like right now they are because it's one or more, so they're going to attack pretty quick. Whoever is the monster's color is on, so the monster right now is on yellow. That means if yellow is here, they automatically die. But if yellow is not here, then this is just going to move over one and then kill if blue's there. If blue's not there, then it just goes over to the next one. And then, so red player will die. Once that has happened, no more people will die in this because one person's already died, and this just moves over to the next one. So that means next round, green either has to get out of there or kill these two, three monsters so they don't attack. So that's the only difference on the Crossroads, and the Crossroads is the only way to get these little extra points right here. Because like these are worth points. Each antidote is worth points at the end, and each surviving hero that you have that are able to get on the helicopter because they have antidotes, that like they're worth more when they're not exhausted, and they're worth less when they are exhausted. Let's take a quick look at some of these action cards that you'd be getting. So like this one right here, If you play this, you can unexhaust one of your characters. So if one of your characters are on the red side, you can just flip it over back to the blue side. You can even do that at the end of the game, so just to get more points. Then we have something like this. This lets you kill two zombies at your location, or actually any location you want. It doesn't have to be at your location. This one attracts three zombies to a location of your choice. If you play this one, this lets you get two extra votes. This kills one. Now, whenever you play one of these cards that has an explosion symbol on it, you have to put an explosion on to one of the tower, either the tower or the armory. So if I played this card, then I have to choose to either add one explosion to the armory or one explosion to the water tower. So I'll just take one of these explosion markers and add it there. Basically, what that means, if that ever gets three explosions on it, that place is destroyed, and basically it's part of the crossroads. Same thing with the water tower. If the water tower gets three explosions on them, then the water tower is destroyed and becomes part of the crossroads. And that's no matter where you play this at. If I played it over here, one explosion has to get added over there. The only time you cannot play action cards, basically, is right after a vote. You cannot play action cards right after a vote. Other than that, you can play these cards anytime you want. So that's this one. So it kills one, but then you also got to add an explosion. When it shows this right here, this means you're just going to count the zombies. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 zombies are going to get attracted to a location randomly drawn from your hand. So you'll take out, so let's say I'm at the hospital. I'm going to take out the hospital card from my hand so I don't draw this one. And then I'm going to pick one at random for the 5 zombies to go to that. So I pick the bank. So they will go over here to the bank. So that's just some of the action cards. Some of the people also can kill zombies. Like if I exhaust this guy, he kills 2 zombies at my location. She does the same thing. She kills 2 zombies at my location, wherever location she's at. Some people have a disadvantage. Like her, every time she moves, she attracts a zombie to wherever she moves at. One zombie. I can exhaust her to let her move and not attract a zombie. So, yeah. Some people are bad. This one, basically, I can just discard one of my cards to redraw one. But, so basically, I'll discard a card, an action card from my hand, and I get to pick, or I get to draw a card from the discard pile. So all the cards that everybody played, I can choose from those on which one I get back. So like I said, each person has their different action, and each person is different. But we'll do that. Basically, keep doing that and keep doing that until we reached round 4. Then once we have completed this one, revealed the card, and got everything, and decided, once we're on round 4 and we've completed all these steps, so all the 4 steps, so the 3 steps in 4, the whole activating tiles, zombies attack, and then everything, voting on who gets what, that's the end of the game. If you have antidotes for your people, then you will score them, even if they're exhausted or not. If they're not exhausted, like she's worth 5, exhausted, she's worth 3. If I have 4 people and I only have 2 antidotes, then only 2 of my people survive. So I can only score for 2 of my people. And they could be any of the 2 people you have. So I will score these for these. Whatever survivors I have at the end, I score 1 point for each antidote. And then I'll also score points for these if I have them. And sometimes some of these action cards might have points on them. Basically with this one, this is pretty, let's talk about this one. This is called Hideout. So basically what this means is if you play this card before a zombie attacks and you're hiding, that means you cannot be voted to get eaten, basically, because you're hiding. So that's a pretty cool one. But yeah, a person with the most points at the end is the winner. And that is, so we just talked about how to play City of Horror, the second game we're playing at game night. So I'll see you guys then.